Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will be discussing the muscles of the anterior compartment of the thigh. And this anterior compartment is the largest compartment of the thigh, mainly due to the quadriceps femoris muscle. But there are other muscles as well, and some of them are actually pretty powerful. And so we will discuss this and all the typical players, such as innervation, attachments, actions, and as always, some clinical considerations. We have one we want to discuss. So as mentioned, the dominant muscle in this compartment, and really in the thigh overall, is the quadriceps femoris muscle, which is in this general region right here. And it extends proximally as well. And as its name would suggest, it has four quad parts. And these parts are often considered as four separate muscles, even though they all have a common distal tendon. But one of these four, the rectus femoris muscle, is going to actually span a longer distance than the others. It's going to cross both the hip and the knee joint. So it's going to run right down the middle, right straight down the middle of the anterior thigh. That's where it gets its name. So that's the rectus femoris. And the other three parts are the vasti muscles. You'll have the vastus lateralis, which is actually the largest. The vastus medialis, so they're exactly where you would think. One's more lateral, one's more medial. And the vastus intermedius, which you can see here up on this BlueLink image, is going to be deep to the rectus femoris. So the rectus femoris had to be removed in order to clearly see that. Again, when looking at the anterior compartment of the thigh, it is the quadriceps femoris muscle, which is dominant and takes up almost all of the view. There are other muscles, though. And in the case of the iliopsoas muscle, that's actually a very powerful muscle in terms of being able to flex the thigh. It is a combination muscle, which means that it kind of has two major parts that come together as a distal tendon. You have the psoas major muscle, which we talked a little bit about when we were talking about the lumbar plexus. And then you also have the iliacus muscle, which is sitting right on the iliac crest portion, or the body of the ilium. And so those two come together and have a common tendon, which is located in the superolateral portion of the anterior compartment, but it's often blocked from view. That distal portion is blocked from view because of these other larger muscles. There is also the sartorius muscle, one of my favorites. It is the most superficial of the muscles of the anterior compartment. So I'm going to kind of trace the sartorius right here. So it's one of the most superficial muscles, and it also has the distinction of being the longest muscle in the body. So it's extending all the way up here from the hip, all the way down here towards the knee. We kind of lose it, but it's going to be right around this region in terms of its insertion. So we will be identifying the sartorius and the iliopsoas in addition to the quadriceps femoris. We are not going to focus on the pectineus muscle, which is located in the superomedial thigh, a deep portion as well. But it is in this region. Almost all of these muscles are innervated by the femoral nerve. So when you are making your chart of which nerve innervates which compartment, go ahead and jot down femoral nerve for the anterior thigh compartment. This is a branch of the lumbar plexus, which is unique. Other than the medial compartment of the thigh and the gluteal region, it is not, those are the only compartments that are not innervated by branches of the sciatic nerve, which is the predominant supply of the lower limb. So again, anterior compartment of the thigh, as well as the gluteal region and medial compartment of the thigh, are the exceptions to the rules. Everything else is sciatic nerve branches. Okay, let's talk a few distal attachments. We're not going to go into every single one of them, but there are a few I want you to know. Starting with the iliopsoas muscle. Recall, you have those two muscles combining. You have the psoas major here and the iliacus. And they will come together and they will share a distal tendon, which is going to attach on the lesser, not the greater, the lesser trochanter of the femur. So when this muscle contracts, it will pull the femur anteriorly, creating powerful flexion. Ooh, that was a squiggly line, but it's moving it more anteriorly. And again, this is going to be your most powerful flexor of the hip joint. I do want to note, but not get into the weeds here, that the iliopsoas, based on its more proximal attachments up here, will actually also allow this muscle to move the trunk. So not only will it affect the hip joint quite powerfully, it can affect the trunk as well. Additionally, you can also see that the iliopsoas muscle does not reach the knee. So in terms of the lower limb, it can only affect the hip joint. Moving to the quadriceps femoris muscle, those four muscle parts will have a common tendon, which is dominant. It plays a very important role in the protection of the anterior knee joint. So you can see that right here. And this is going to be called the quadriceps tendon. So this portion right here is called the quadriceps tendon. Now, a sesamoid bone will actually form within the quadriceps tendon called the patella, often colloquially referred to as the kneecap. And this bone provides a bony surface in the anterior knee region. It helps to withstand compression in this region and provide protection during movements of the knee joint. And again, and we'll get into this when we get into the knee joint, the anterior part of the capsule of the knee joint isn't particularly strong, so you have all of this region here to add that protection. The portion of the quadriceps tendon from the patella to the tibial tuberosity of the tibia, which is the distalmost attachment, is often referred to as the patellar ligament. Sometimes you hear it referred to, it's called ligament sometimes because it's going from bone, the patella, to the tibial tuberosity. But you often hear it referred to as the patellar tendon as well because it is an extension of that tendon. So let's talk actions, and we can divide these into muscles that cross the hip joint and those that cross the knee joint. The prominent movement associated with this compartment and the hip joint is flexion of the hip joint. And you can see the hip being flexed on this patient on the left side here. So moving anteriorly. And as mentioned, this is primarily the iliopsoas muscle, but the rectus femoris portion of the quadriceps can play a role, that pectineus can play a role, and sartorius too. So the sartorius muscle is a very clearly observable muscle. It's going to be one of the first things you see because it's so superficial, but it's not a particularly powerful muscle. It plays synergistic roles and actions that allows an individual to kind of sit in a cross-legged position. By far the most prominent movement of the knee joint and for this compartment will be extension of the knee joint, which is facilitated by all components of the quadriceps femoris muscle. So this illustration here is showing the knee in extension, such as what you have in standing. But think of other times extension is used. So if you're rising from a sitting or squatting position, you're going to extend the knees. If you're climbing, you're walking upstairs, to name a few, those are all examples of where extension is going to play a role. Lastly, I want to touch on one clinical consideration in this area, which is the patellar tendon ligament, either way you'll hear both, reflex. And this test involves tapping with a firm stroke the patellar ligament with a reflex hammer, as you can see happening here. And hopefully this is going to elicit kind of a jerky extension of the knee, which you can see happening right there. So eliciting a patellar reflex or knee jerk. And tapping right here at the ligament tendon region is going to activate muscle spindles in the quadriceps femoris muscle, sending afferent impulses from the spindles through the femoral nerve to the L2 through L4 segments of the spinal cord. And from there, efferent impulses are transmitted via motor fibers in the femoral nerve to the quadriceps, which is what is going to result in that jerky extension movement of the knee. So don't worry about breaking down. You don't have to memorize these specific numbers here of this illustration. It's just here to kind of show you the set here. Focus more on what we have over here in the text. So really this patellar reflex is testing the integrity of the L2 through L4 spinal cord segments because that, you know, obviously is directly associated with the femoral nerve as well. So it can test whether there are issues there. So a pretty common test during routine physical exams. And I am sure your clinical friends will show you how to do this most appropriately. Excellent. We have reached the summary slide, and I thank you very, very much for your time and attention here. If after this review you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues. We always love to talk anatomy. Have a great rest of your day.